Well, hello again, and welcome to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. I'm Tom. As always, I'm with my wonderful, gorgeous, super smart, hardworking, Donald Duck loving wife and co-host, Michelle.
Thank you, honey. Hi, everybody.
So good to have you with us. We're recording this episode on Sunday, November 29th, 2020. We hope you all had a wonderful and healthy and safe Thanksgiving out there.
That's right. And however you decided to celebrate Thanksgiving, as Tom said, hope it was wonderful and that you all are safe. And if you've traveled, that you return home safely.
Right, exactly. We had a very pared down Thanksgiving here, just the three of us.
Right.
But we had, I think, food for like eight people.
Yeah,
because we're
say.
Still going through the leftovers now as we're recording this on Sunday.
Right. I was going to say, we didn't pare down on food.
No.
Yes.
You know us. We love our food. I wasn't going to make like a little, you know, individual meal for us. No,
right.
It was still the whole thing, the turkey, all the sides, everything, and we're still going through it. And plus, I made turkey soup too.
Yeah. Those leftovers are amazing, and the soup is delicious. So it's all good. It's great.
Let me give you an early tip. By the way, don't think that the turkey carcass, it is a leftover as well.
Right.
It's easy to make a turkey soup using the carcass. And plus, any meat that you have left on there that you have not carved
right.
off, it all comes out. And when you use that, if you want to hit me up, I'll let you know how to do a turkey soup. So in the future, if you don't know, I mean, it's pretty simple to do. But it, believe me, it extends the life of your leftovers. And it's just, especially at this time of year, as it's getting a little chillier, it's just really nice to have that for the next few days to come.
Definitely. Maybe that's something you can put in the newsletter.
Maybe so.
Ooh.
Maybe. We'll see about that. We'll see about that. Thank you for joining us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
then you can sign up for the newsletter.
And sign up for the newsletter and see if I put the turkey soup recipe in there. Not this week, but maybe eventually. And again, you can hit us up still just the same. We also love hearing from you on social media. We're very interactive on social media. Please hit us up out there on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. Hopefully you're watching some of these episodes on YouTube. We have, we add some pictures. We add just some fun stuff on there. So you can kind of get a visual of everything going on, not just listen to us. So please check us out on YouTube. If you want to find us there, just do a search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast, hit subscribe, and you'll know whenever we have a brand new video. And if you ever want to contact us for any reason, please hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
That's right. And we love hearing from you. If you have any questions, any ideas or suggestions you want to make sure that we're delving into, please let us know. And for those of you who wrote this week, thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much. We had a couple of listener input emails this week that we'll be getting to when we get to our main topic. We also wanted to mention that we've teased this a couple times, and it did actually come out this week. We are on the latest episode of the Conversations podcast with Pat and Charles. We had just a fantastic time with them. Just laughed a lot talking about Disney and Lucasfilm tie-ins, so Star Wars and Disney tie-ins. Whether it be the films, whether it be the attractions in the park, the cruise line.
Right.
We just had a great time with them, and we definitely suggest that you check out that show and check out all their shows, because Pat and Charles are just great guys and very fun and entertaining.
Exactly. I was going to say the same kind of thing. That's a podcast you'll want to subscribe to every week and listen to. Very entertaining, very informative. And as you mentioned, they're great. They're great hosts. It was really fun doing the show with them, and I look forward to bringing them back onto our show.
Yeah, absolutely. They'll be back on again, because they're just a great couple guys. Their show is, it's informational. You get to learn a lot about Star Wars if you listen to it, but it's also just entertaining, because those guys are a hoot. They're just really, really fun guys.
Very entertaining.
So definitely go check them out. As for our show, on today's show, we have lots of stuff for you this week, including great news if you're looking for a different way to travel to and from the Walt Disney World Resort while you're within Florida. And if you've ever looked into a Disney fountain or Disney attraction water and wondered, what do they do with all those coins that people throw in there? Well, we have some information for you about what they've done with some recently. But let's get to our main topic of the week. So yes, our main topic this week, you know, it was just, I don't know what struck us. I think we were watching The Three Caballeros the other day or whatever.
And DuckTales, I think, a combination.
Right, and which is, you just heard a bit of the theme song there. Mm-hmm. It just kind of drove us to like, you know, it was just Mickey's birthday. Everybody celebrates Mickey and Minnie, of course, and that's great. But you know who gets a little underappreciated sometimes, I think, is Donald Duck.
Right.
And so we thought, you know, we could have waited until his birthday, which is not till like next summer. I'm like, I don't want to wait that long. We should really get into Donald Duck because he is one of the most entertaining characters in Disney of all time. Mm-hmm. We've also heard some things about him being one of the most important characters in Disney of all time, but we needed to make sure that that is true. So of course we sent Michelle out on a research journey because she loves to do research and she does the very best research.
Oh, man.
So she's going to go through a little bit of Donald Duck in our Donald Duck appreciation show.
Right. So first of all, it was funny because we did have a great topic that we've now postponed, which is going to be fun to do at another time. But yeah, Donald Duck was fun. I was glad you actually suggested that and to put it up sooner. And so you may believe you know everything about Donald Duck, but I think there might be a few things that we can draw out today that might be new information for anybody.
I have no doubt, coming from your research, because your research is always so good, that we're bound to have some things that I didn't know about Donald Duck that's going to come out, and I'm sure that will be true of all of you out there as well.
Well, let's hope so. And, you know, as you mentioned, Donald Duck's been one of the Disney's biggest stars. I mean, yes, Mickey Mouse, but Donald Duck is pretty much up there as well. And he's actually made more theatrical appearances than Mickey Mouse. So, but yeah, we're going to go into a look at his beginnings and some of the essence of what makes Donald Duck different and some of the projects he was brought in to do and how they were important to our nation, actually.
Yeah, very good. So I'm looking forward to hearing all of this. I'm sure there's some great facts here. Michelle, research, always the best.
All right, so let's start the very beginning. His first film was a short called The Wise Little Hen. Oh. And actually, that was from 1934, and you can watch that on Disney Plus. That one is one of the ones that is currently playing on Disney Plus. So you can kind of see where he started. And he did make a lot of appearances in the 1930s in shorts, but it's really considered the 1940s as the Donald decade, where his fame really just skyrocketed.
I like that. Remember whenever we do an episode on, you know, with Disney in the 40s, it'll be the Donald decade.
The Donald decade. Yes. That's right. And, you know, doing some research with one of the sites that I really like to gather some information is the Walt Disney Family Museum site. And they have a blog there and they did address that. And they actually said in the 1940s, Donald Duck's achievements were unequal to any other cartoon character in that decade. So he played a lot of He was out there. He played a big role in a lot of things.
Right. So. Yeah. I mean, I don't think there's any question. I think if you really think about it and think of all the stuff that Donald has appeared in, yes, Mickey, you know, it was all started by a mouse.
Right.
But Donald is really in many ways, a lot of the face of Disney.
Exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, they did, you know, at first Donald wasn't necessarily starring with Mickey Mouse. And there's other cartoon shorts that he's been with, Pluto or Chip and Dale and things like that. But there were, you know, he was paired with Mickey in several of them. And, you know, what the unique qualities that both of those had and played were very important with what was going on in our country at the time. So, you know, they considered like Mickey was the everyman, right? So of the Depression era, and that his and that Donald Duck had more of that fighting spirit that was associated with what was going on with the war. So they kind of felt that those two balanced each other. And in fact, it's said that like Mickey, he showed that with tenacity and good spirits, you could overcome any of the adversities that were going on, like with the depression. And that Donald actually showed that that fighting spirit could get the job done.
Wow.
So they really used those personality types to kind of drive home what was going on in our nation at the time.
Right, I love it. That totally makes sense, but you never really thought about it, but that's a really interesting point.
Yeah. So what made Donald unique was some of the projects that he was brought into. So starting with August of 1941, Walt was reached out to by the Canadian government to come up with some animated cartoons to help sell their war bonds, you know, and
by Canada.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. So they actually called them war saving certificates. So in the film that Donald was in, he engaged in this like mental conflict that was going on. So it was like what to do with his pay or his salary. And so he had the devil side of him saying, you know, spend it on yourself, do things that you want to do. And then the angel side was saying, you know what, you really should probably be investing some of that money into war certificates. And so do the right thing. And that's how Donald resolved his conflict, that he did what was considered the right thing and helped support the war efforts for Canada.
Fascinating.
I know, right?
Yeah. Canada. That's a little surprising, but that's really cool.
I know. So as a result of that, then there was this thought, hey, why not use them in the United States?
Why is it going north of the border first?
Right? You know? So the U.S. Treasury Department also, tapped into Walt to say, hey, we could really use some help. One of their biggest challenges was that getting people to understand the importance of paying their taxes and their income taxes to help our war effort as well. So they did do two films. One's called The New Spirit and the other one is The Spirit of 43 that, you know, Donald was involved in. And the interesting thing is that when the War Department and Treasury Department were talking to Walt, I mean, he was very patriotic and he was like, yes, I'm all in on this. And at the disgruntlement of Roy, he did some things either very discounted or for free to help these efforts. But, you know, it was just really interesting to think that the Disney company and their use of their characters, and Donald wasn't the only one, but he was one of the biggest stars for some of these issues, was tapped in on as a resource. And that was what was found to be very successful. In fact, these films that they did a Gallup poll and 37% of the people who saw the film said their decision to you know, make sure they're paying their taxes and income taxes on time was very much influenced by Donald Duck's film.
Wow, that's very impressive, Donald. Good job.
I know.
I mean, he is a sailor. I mean, he's in a sailor suit. He's part of the Navy, right? So, of course, he's going to, you know, you're going to listen to the guy in the spiffy uniform, right?
Right? Exactly. So, I mean, I just thought those things were pretty fascinating. Yeah. That, I mean, I had heard before that Donald Duck was in some films, some training films, et cetera, for the war efforts. But the fact that they actually had a specific purpose, right, and that he used those talents in Canada as well. So, hey, pretty cool.
Pretty much most of North America.
That's right.
By Donald Duck. Thank you, Donald.
So in the 50s, actually, the schools, the education department was having a challenge. And I think this is probably one of those longstanding challenges, is the issue of mathematics and mathematics being considered something that's pretty good or cool or whatever. So again, the Walt Disney Company was tapped in on to say, how can you help with this? And again, you know, Walt was like, okay, what would be the character that could be connected with kids to have this interest? And so naturally he went with Donald. And
I don't think of Donald as a math scholar for
I know,
okay,
but you can connect with him. And so,
that's fine.
Right. And so he starred in Donald in Mathemagic Land.
Wow.
And, you know, so he was, used to really try to help emphasize that math is a great subject. It's fun. It's useful. And although it's not on Disney Plus, you can get a DVD on it. I suspect at some point it'll come to Disney Plus.
Probably.
But right now, so I went on to Shop Disney to see if they had it there. Obviously, they have it on other sites as well, but Shop Disney does have it. And here's how they described it, which I thought was so adorable. This highly acclaimed Academy Award nominating film is one of the most popular and entertaining educational films ever made by Walt Disney. Mm-hmm. A curious Donald Duck ventures into a mystical world of fantasy, a wondrous land of discovery where trees have square roots and rivers are brimming with numbers. During this lively journey, Donald discovers that you can mix mirth with math, fun with fractions, and laugh with logic in this fascinating and timeless milestone in Disney's animation legacy.
Cool.
I know.
I think, you know, I may have seen this at some point, or I've at least seen portions of it, because that description sounds very familiar to me, like
right?
The square roots and the numbers in the river or whatever.
You right.
know, that sounds very familiar to me. So I don't know if I saw this on A Wonderful World of Disney at some point
or
something along those lines. And again, it may have been only a snippet of it, not the whole
right,
thing.
But exactly.
It sounds familiar to me.
Right, right. And I think it was on several different things. I saw that it had like four different releases on TV. So, and it was made available for schools and things like that.
Maybe I saw it in school.
Yeah. So, yeah. Although you don't think of Donald as the scholar, I think the concept was if you can get Donald
right.
interested in math.
People are going to sit down and watch Donald.
Yeah. And find the fun.
Plus, I've gotten as mad as he gets at math sometimes. I've wanted to get out there and go, why
right?
you math? Darn so, fractions.
Yeah, I can't do this. Or why would I even want to know right. this? So, yeah. But again, it's really interesting that Donald does have that kind of appeal to so many people, whether you're talking with students or military mm-hmm. or just citizens. It's just Donald does have that attachment that people can feel maybe an equal to, you know, Mickey, maybe sometimes you might feel like he's just a little too nice.
Right.
I don't know, but I'm just giving some ideas.
Donald, you can relate to a little bit more.
Right,
we all
right.
get angry like Donald.
Yeah,
we all get frustrated like Donald.
Exactly.
You know? He can be happy too. And he can be in love. He's in love a lot.
That's true.
Especially with Daisy. But, you know, we saw the Three Caballeros, or just go check out the Gran Fiesta Tour.
Right.
He's in love a lot.
So that is true. So he had a lot of jobs in his film features and things. Can you remember any of them?
He's a sailor. No, I'm trying to
We've
recall.
Actually saw something not too long ago around Halloween.
Oh, he was a ghost hunter.
Right. Paranormal yes. investigator.
Right. That's right. Yeah.
And the Lonesome Ghost.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, him and Mickey and Goofy all
right.
three of them. Yeah.
Right. So this is not an all-inclusive list, but it just kind of shows you how talented Donald Duck is. He played a fire chief in a short called Fire Chief from 1941, a scout leader.
Okay.
A logger.
A logger. Wow.
More time up in Canada, I'm
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, I guess so.
Steam shovel operator.
Okay.
A musician.
That makes sense.
Right. Hotel bellboy.
Donald guy has to get really frustrated at some of these, the luggage that people bring in, I'm sure, as a bellboy.
Right, right. And a clock cleaner. As I mentioned, that's not all of them. That's just, you know, some of the highlight ones.
Yeah.
But super, super duper talented.
Yeah. Boy, he does everything. A little
right?
bit of everything.
Right? A little bit of everything. So he is so famous that he actually has two theme songs.
All right. Yeah.
So I think if you could help me out, I'd like to play, first of all, the one that most people associate with him that's at the beginning of all his shorts.
Who's got the sweetest disposition? One guess, guess who? Who never, never starts an argument? Who never shows a bit of temperament? Who's never wrong but always right? Who never dreams of starting a fight? Who gets stuck with all the bad luck? No one but Donald Duck.
So yeah, I think that's the one that most people know and associate with him. It is at the opening of the shorts that he's the star in. So that's cool. But he actually has another theme song that was written, I guess, back in the 50s, I believe, with within the Mickey Mouse Club, that they actually did a little feature all about Donald, and they also included a new song.
Know something, Donald? You're a big international favorite.
You're kidding. Huh,
no fooling. Wait till you see these drawings with the music. They'll prove it. They're great.
Okay. Shall we?
Gentlemen, a one, a two.
Wah, 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 Donald Duck, he's my little pal. Wah, 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 Donald Duck, Daisy is his gal. Wah, 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 Donald Duck, in his sailor suit. Wah, 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 Donald Duck, gee, I think he's cute. I like the way he waddles, and I like to hear him talk. And when somebody makes him mad, wah, 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 oh, he can squawk. Wah, 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 Donald Duck, cocky as can be. Wah, 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 Donald Duck, here's what he taught me. When someone knocks you down, get right up again. Show some pluck like Donald Duck.
So great.
I know. But you know what? That really captures the essence of Donald Duck. You know, the fact that, you know, he is in love, as you mentioned, but he also has issues and gets knocked down, but has the gumption to come back.
Oh, and again, and again, and again. Right? Yeah. Again, he's very relatable. You know, we have emotions. He has emotions.
Right.
You know, and so does Mickey, but Mickey usually tends to be on the high side of happy-go-lucky guy. Yeah, I think more people can relate to what Donald goes through on a day in and day out basis.
Right. And I think the day in the life kind of things, when you look at Mickey, you know, he might have something that's a little, you know, cause a little bump in the road, but nothing major. But Donald, when things go wrong with him, it's usually major.
Yes. And a lot of times it's from his own doing, but
right?
You know, that's all part of it.
So another fun fact is, you know, and as we mentioned in some of the things, he has won an Academy Award for Best Short Subject Cartoon in 1943. And what's really interesting is not only did Donald win that Academy Award during that decade, but he also had 7 Academy Award nomination short cartoons in comparison to Mickey, who only had 7.
Mm.
So he had more nominations. They each had 1 win. So, but Donald Duck, if you compare him to other male actors who have received nominations, only Jack Nicholson, who has 12 nominations, beats Donald Duck.
Wow, that 11 from Donald Duck. That's pretty crazy.
Right? So, again, you may have thought he was famous, but, I mean, this guy was nominated left and right here.
Yeah.
And because he's such a great star, he also has a star on Hollywood's Walk of Fame.
That makes sense. I think I've seen that star. You haven't been to Hollywood down the Walk
I
of Fame,
know.
The real Walk of Fame yet. We still need to... We may be going up there hopefully in around April,
right.
So maybe you'll get a chance to do it then. But
I'll have to check out Donald's star there.
Definitely. I've seen Minnie's star there. I think I've seen Mickey's star there.
Wow.
Walt Disney's star as well there.
Very cool. Very cool. So, you know, as you can see, big star, big movie star. And, you
Definitely.
Know, we know he's been in a ton of shorts, you know, whether they were ones that he was a star or that he was a character within it.
Mm-hmm.
But he also made appearances in some movie releases. So one of the things that we talked about is the Three Caballeros,
yes.
But he was also in Saludos Amigas.
Mm.
Amigos? Boy, I can't even talk. Fun and Fancy Free.
Okay, sure.
Yeah, where he was with Mickey and the Beanstalk in
right.
that one.
Okay.
Another one that had several shorts within that film release was Melody Time. And he was in a sequence called Blame It on the Samba. And Donald actually gets taught how to samba by Jose.
Oh, yeah. Also from the Three Caballeros.
Right, exactly. Then he had kind of he had other things that he was working on at that time. So
he's building a family with Daisy.
Right.
He's going to take a little break from the limelight for a little
That's
bit.
That's right. Let some other characters start building their careers.
Right.
So, but back in 1988, he was also in Who Framed Roger Rabbit. And that was a really great scene between him and Daffy Duck.
Right, which was great. groundbreaking to right? have a Warner Brothers character. I mean, that is so much of Who Framed Roger Rabbit was right, groundbreaking, right. but Warner Brothers character and a Disney character on the same screen together.
Yes, yeah. exactly. And it's funny because there are some things that are similar in their personalities, and seeing that dueling pianos yeah. Go on was just fabulous. I thought that was super
yeah,
creative.
If you haven't checked out Who Framed Roger Rabbit recently on Disney Plus, go check it out because it still is a great movie.
Right.
Stands up. It's fantastic. And then just all the Easter eggs and cameos throughout it.
Right.
It's just brilliantly done.
Exactly. So he also made a cameo appearance in a Goofy movie. And he also starred in one of the featurettes of Fantasia 2000. So
in a Goofy movie, he makes the cameo, which you can spot.
Right.
But also he's mentioned.
Yes.
As far as, you know, well, I'm going to take my best pal to go fishing.
Right.
And Max is like, who, Donald Duck?
I know. It's funny that he says that and not Mickey. So, right. you know. But,
well, he's Kingdom Hearts together, so.
Right. Oh, you're getting into some of my territory
sorry,
here. Hey,
sorry,
back it off. No, I'm just kidding. But actually, we're getting into some of the other places and sightings and things that Donald was used for. So one of them is Disney attractions, way more than Mickey Mouse, for sure. So starting in Disneyland Paris, he was in a Magique. I'm really having a struggle talking
it's
today.
Okay.
So that was a staged musical tribute to Disney animation. Mm-hmm. So Donald was in that. That did retire in 2016, but that was there. Another place that he starred was Mickey Mouse Review. That started at Walt Disney World when they first opened in 71. Then it moved over to Japan, mm-hmm. and it retired after that, but he was in that. And in that same location at Walt Disney World Magic Kingdom is Mickey's PhilharMagic,
mm-hmm.
and he's obviously in that.
Right. Now in Disneyland, too, Disney California Adventure Park,
right.
they finally added PhilharMagic as well just last summer, I believe.
A little over a year ago.
Right.
Yeah. Speaking of Disneyland, he was also, during their 50th anniversary, he was in a film that was called The First 50 Magical Years that mm-hmm. was in like the Lincoln Theater.
Okay.
And that, so he was in there. As you mentioned, you can spot him on Grand Fiesta Tour
yeah.
where he's starring with the three Caballeros. And we see him in It's a Small World. So
at Disneyland.
Right. At Disneyland. So, you know.
And again, with the three Caballeros.
Right. Right. Yeah. So he's, you know, he's made an appearance at a lot of park attractions. So,
yeah.
You can also see him in a restaurant at Disney World. Can you remember
where? Mm.
He plays a little appearance in a place.
No, I don't recall. Where is it?
It's the Sci-Fi Dine-In.
Oh.
He's in one of the...
One of the little shorts?
Right. So you can catch him
makes
there.
Makes sense.
Right. So as you mentioned, he's been in video games, Kingdom Hearts. And can you do the line?
Sora, Donald, Goofy.
Perfect.
<Yes. laughs>
He was also in Disney Infinity 2.0 and in Infinity 3.0, he was part of the tutorial section.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So,
can you understand him speaking in the tutorial
I know,
section?
Right? It's like, well whatever. That's part of the fun.
Very confusing tutorial.
Right?
Not, this doesn't help at all. I don't understand a word this duck is telling me.
And obviously, he's been in comic books. In fact, he had his start was in comic books, and that has gone on and on. I mean, he's had a very long career. Internationally, he's still very popular in the comic book scene. He has, in some countries, like a secondary persona, which is a cape-wearing Avenger-type character. Mm. And so it's when I saw some of the images, it kind of looked a little bit like Darkwing Duck.
Oh, so it's not, I was going to say, it's not Darkwing Duck, because
no,
that's a different character.
Yeah, no. He has a different name. It's based on the country, you know, that he's in.
Interesting.
So, right. And obviously, you can catch him on Disney Plus in a ton of locations.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I was going to get into some of the top five ways you can see him in Disney Plus,
well,
unless you have some other
thoughts. I don't, no. Although we did hear at some point, I think we part of what inspired this is when we were on one of our tours at, I can't remember if it was Disneyland over at Magic Kingdom, but one of the tour guides who really loves Donald Duck.
Right.
And this person told us is like, you know, if you think about where who's made the most money for Disney, it's not Mickey Mouse.
Right.
It's because of all the things that you mentioned there. It's Donald Duck because he's been in the most shorts. He's been in the most movies. He is actually the Disney character, especially of the Sensational Six, the original group. That has brought in a lot of money to Disney. And so I, you know, I thought that, you know, he didn't really think about it up until that point. You always just assume Mickey Mouse because he's, you know, he started it all. Right.
Exactly.
But no, Donald has been, and maybe the, it is because like you mentioned, he is every man.
Right.
You
know? Right.
I mean, everybody can kind of understand.
Right.
Maybe not how he speaks, but you can understand his feelings in a lot of ways, Donald Duck.
Exactly. I mean, I think it's also says a lot for the company that they had consistency for Donald Duck with the animators and the voice actors, you know, and really made sure they had some preparations for transitioning those roles. But I think obviously that that provides some substance to, you know, the Donald Duck you're going to see is going to look the way you expect. I mean, although he has had changes over the years, but you know, it feels right because it's what you expect and what you expect to hear.
Well, when we heard when we saw the Three Caballeros screened on the Disney Studios lot so long ago, it seems like, although I think it was only about a year ago actually, that we, Tony Anselmo, who is the current voice of Donald Duck, was there, and he described that, the, you know, the how what he had to go through, the original voice, and I'm sorry his name escapes me right at this moment, and I apologize for that, but he would take Tony in and, you know, what would Donald say during this time, knowing that, that Tony was probably going to take over for him, or he wanted him to take over for him as the voice of Donald. And so he prepped him for a long time of, you know, not just, you know, quack like Donald Duck, or just speak to me like Donald Duck. No, what would Donald do in a certain situation?
Right. And what words would he use?
Right, exactly.
It's not like just a direct translation of, you know, what a screenwriter would put on as the script. It's what words, what phrases would Donald
use? So it laid down the groundwork for Tony to take over and, you know, for not to skip a beat as far as Donald goes.
Exactly.
And what you expect from Donald. Yeah.
Exactly. So, anything else that you can think of or questions you have?
No, I want to hear your top five list. I didn't make one, so this is just Michelle's. She's doing the research on this, so I can't wait to hear what she has to say.
So, top five ways to watch Donald Duck on Disney Plus currently. And I picked these because I think they show the real essence that you could see him in from where he started to even now, even though he does have somewhat of a different look. And I have to say, the newer, you know, Mickey and Donald and Goofy shorts, although they have a different look to them, the writing on those features are brilliant. I think that what they're presenting there is so so high quality of a topic and what how they're presenting it. So
the writing is great. Now you know, you can judge for yourself on what you feel like Mickey and Donald and Goofy should look like, classic versus more modern style. But the writing and the storylines, The Wonderful World of Mickey Mouse, which is just debuted a few weeks ago on Disney Plus, has some brilliant shorts. I think they're fantastic.
Right.
They're some of the best I've seen so far. And matter of fact, we're going to probably watch a few more this weekend because I know a few more just dropped. So,
So, but anyways, the ones that I picked here are more showing the historical ones. So I'm not, I just don't want to make it seem like those newer things aren't worthy of. They are great. I don't know that they're necessarily just focusing on Donald on those right now. So these films focus on Donald. So my number five pick would be the band concert, you know, and I think that one, it's classic, it's creative. And, you know, I think you totally get the essence and the type of play off of each other that Mickey and Donald have. So I think that gives a lot of great evidence of that. One that's purely Donald, and it just really, to me, captures the essence of this poor duck has problems with everything. And it's called Early to Bed. It's a short and it's just hilarious. And it, how he can just, with something so easy as trying to go to bed and all the things that make that a challenge.
Can you relate to that a little bit?
Definitely. Definitely can. So that's my number four. Great. My number three is Stuck on Christmas. That's on the Mickey Once Upon a Christmas.
One of the three stories.
One of the three. That, yeah. In fact, it's the first one. Mm-hmm. And there I think you do get to see the relationship with Donald and Daisy, as well as Donald and his nephews. And yeah. I think it
Scrooge McDuck is in that,
right,
as well.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think you get a good grasp of relationships, mm-hmm, with others there, and get to see what those characters, mm-hmm, are like as well. And my number two would be The Three Caballeros. Again,
of course. Yeah, so good.
Again, classic. It's something that's funny. It's got some great music in, mm-hmm, there and everything. And my number one way to watch Donald Duck, and it's on Disney Plus, and I would say it anyways, is The Plausible Impossible. Mm-hmm. So if you're doing a search for Donald Duck, this one won't come up per se, okay, if you just put in Donald Duck. But it's called The Plausible Impossible. And it's really a kind of like a documentary that Walt is giving on how they utilize that technique in cartoons of taking something that really is totally impossible, but making your mind think it's possible or it's plausible, you know. And I think one of the ones, and it's not just unique to Disney, I think one of the classic things that you see in a lot of cartoons are animated, because it's even in Cars, is that a character falls off a ledge and doesn't actually drop until they, right, realize it.
Right.
You know, and
which
so,
is, of course, ridiculous, but, you know, it seems to work. You know,
exactly.
It's plausible and possible.
That's
perfect.
Right. You know, so the way that animators utilize that tool and the way Walt is telling the story of how his animators use this is through the use of Donald Duck. And, you know, and it's hilarious. So definitely would suggest, if you can't watch,
yeah,
or great, if you don't want to watch all of them, that's one to go to.
That's a great one. Yeah, that's really good. And it does give you the idea of what the animators and the storytellers go through to kind of,
right,
figure out how to, you know, put these characters in these situations.
Exactly.
You know, that are both, you know, interesting and humorous, you know.
Right. Very edutainment.
Edutainment, very much so. Very nice.
Yeah. So, anyways, that's a look back of Donald Duck and some of the finer details that most people might not be, right, quite as aware of.
Such a great character, one of our favorites. Mm-hmm. He's great to, you know, find in the parks and get a photo with, you know,
right,
or meet and greet when those come back and everything. But just so entertaining. I mean, he's just, I mean, who doesn't crack up when he gets all worked up about something? You
exactly.
Know? It's just so good.
Exactly. So. I mean, and like I said, he's been put into so many different types of characters and careers. And you, one, I guess, could argue Mickey's similar, but you, mm-hmm, don't necessarily see that with all the other characters. You don't see Goofy playing a lot of different, you know, roles. You know,
it's not quite as many, I don't think.
Right.
Although he did always, you know, learn to swim, you know.
Right. Yeah. He was, yeah. You saw him more into, right, some of the
more, he's more
sport
in activities. Yeah. He's more into it. Not necessarily jobs, just activities.
Exactly. Yeah. So, but, you know, and so I think, the, you know, some of those things are what makes Donald unique in the star that he deserve being.
Yeah, no, I think he's great. I love Donald so much, and that's part of the reason why we decided, you know, we should do this episode.
Yeah,
to show our love for this great character who's meant so much to the Disney company in general, but just to us too. And I'm,
yeah,
sure you love him too. And matter of fact, speaking of that, we did get a couple comments. I put this out on the newsletter this week of, you know, what do you think about, you know, Donald Duck?
Right.
What's your best memories? And we got a couple replies. Not a lot, but we got a couple. One was from Taylor Knight. She emailed in and said, my sister and I loved all the Donald Duck with Chip and Dale cartoons as kids. You know, those are the,
right,
best.
Yes.
Yeah, Chip and Dale and Donald, they just drove, they drove Donald crazy.
Right.
Yeah. She going on to say, the banter back and forth still makes me laugh. I also love the short where Humphrey the Bear pretends to be Donald's rug.
Yes.
And then she says, who gets stuck with all the bad luck? No one but Donald Duck. Yes. So good. Thank you, Taylor.
Yes.
Yeah, I totally agree with all those.
Good points.
Finally, Scott in Minnesota sent us an email and said, ask Michelle to research why he never wears pants. And I actually have the answer for that. It's because Mickey has them. If you ever see them walking down the street together, Mickey's wearing pants with no shirt a lot of times. And Donald has a shirt on with no pants.
Right,
a lot of
times, right.
You know? So that's the reason that apparently there was only one outfit when Disney first started. And so they had to decide which one was best, half and half there.
Right. Yeah. Maybe just so he could swim and not, you know, cover the tail that helps him, you know, be his rudder and everything.
That's a good point. I always, my favorite thing is like, why does Donald, like, you know, he doesn't wear pants all day long, but he gets out of the shower and wraps a towel around himself.
Because he's still wet. He doesn't want to drip on the floor.
That must be it.
So. You know, so.
Anyway, right. So great job, Michelle. Always does the best research. We love Donald Duck very much. And we would love to know what you still think of Donald, some of your favorite things that you watched on Disney Plus, some of your favorite memories of him. If any information, please send it to us and we'll share it on an upcoming show. Oh, and we got to take this out with, you only mentioned it a little bit, but he also, yes, he's not the biggest part of this show, but he is in DuckTales. And any chance I get to play the DuckTales theme, I'm going to do it. So here we go. Danger lurks behind you. There's a stranger out to find you. What to do? Just grab onto some DuckTales. Ooh. Every day they're out there making DuckTales. Ooh. Tales of daring, do bad and good luck tales. Ooh. Every day they're out there making DuckTales. Ooh. Tales of daring, bad and good, not funny tales of gods and tales of DuckTales. Ooh.
That's awesome. So we, you know, when we were talking, before we totally walk away from Donald Duck here, when we were talking with your family on Thanksgiving during our family Zoom, the Mandalorian came up, shocking. And it was funny because one of the comments your cousin mentioned is that the Mandalorian, everywhere he goes, has problems. You know, it's never an easy situation. He's got to, you know, do something. And to me, maybe because I was just working on this episode, but it's like, the Mandalorian is the Donald Duck of Star Wars universe.
He doesn't get quite as worked up as Donald. He's more low key. Like, he's just kind of one level most of the time. He doesn't get super excited. He doesn't get super high, super low.
You don't see his face. Maybe underneath. Underneath.
Underneath, he's like, yeah. Why I oughta. Very funny. Yeah, and my cousin brought up, he's like, why don't we have like an episode where he's just going to the grocery store, sitting down at a bar and having a drink? I'm like, because who would watch that?
Right?
You know, what interest is that? Mandalorian, still great. Another great episode this week. Loved it so much. So let's get to our Disney stories of the week. Not a lot going on this week, I think, because of Thanksgiving happening. But I do have a couple stories for you that I want to get to. I'm going to start with, we had some fantastic news arrive this week if you're looking for another way to get to and from the Walt Disney World Resort within Florida. This from the OrlandoSentinel.com. Brightline and Walt Disney World announced Monday an agreement to build a station at Disney Springs for the upscale high-speed rail service based in South Florida and now building track to Orlando International Airport. That's great. And I think Walt would love it too, because Walt loves trains.
Right, exactly.
So the passenger rail company had previously announced that it was in talks with Disney over a stop near its theme parks as part of a planned extension from the airport to Tampa. Service from South Florida to Orlando's airport is set to start in 2022. Brightline officials have also said they're interested in eventual service to Jacksonville. So basically connecting virtually all the major airports within Florida. It starts in Miami. It goes through Fort Lauderdale, West Palm Beach, Orlando. Eventually, it's going to go to Tampa, possibly Jacksonville. And now, as we hear, they're working on a station at Disney Springs as well. So whether you're going to, you know, fly into Miami and spend some time down there, or you're flying into Orlando or Walt Disney, going to Walt Disney World, and you want to, you know, explore some other spots in Florida, you'll have your chance coming up here within a few years.
Yeah, I think it's great, and looking forward to actually trying that train out. And it's long overdue. It's mm-hmm. it's been something that has been in talks for so many decades. And so it's great to see it happening.
It'd be very helpful if, like, say you want to, because right now it's easy to do a, say, a Walt Disney World stay either before and, or after or and after mm-hmm. Your Disney cruise, you know, right. and they have, you know, it's not that far to get to Port Canaveral. They do have transportation if
right.
you want to
right.
Use it there for a fee to get from Walt Disney World to and from Port Canaveral. Now you'll be able to, like, if there's a sailing out of Miami, mm-hmm. you can take this train from Walt Disney World, well, not now, but when it's available, down to Miami, Fort Lauderdale. I mean, and I'm saying for Disney cruises, but also for other cruise lines, right. whatever. Or if you just want to have, you know, a different part of your vacation, if it's easier for you to fly into Miami, especially mm-hmm. maybe if you're flying from some of the, you know, across the pond, you
right.
know, from Europe or something. A lot of times the direct flights don't necessarily go into Orlando right. as frequently, but, you know, there's Miami is a major hub for a lot of airlines, you know,
yes.
So much easier to get into Miami. And then rather than having to do a connecting flight, you can hop on the train and high speed rail. So it won't take that long to
right.
get there. So
nice.
That'd be really nice. So Brightline did not disclose exactly when the station will be at Disney Springs. The company said the, quote, proposed location would be in close proximity to Walt Disney World Resort's 4 theme parks, 2 water parks, and more than 25 hotels, end
nice.
Quote. So that's exciting news. And we love taking the train. We've taken the train from down here in San Diego up to Anaheim
right.
to go to the Disneyland Resort. And that's a lot of fun, too. And,
right,
and
right.
It's a slow speed rail, but it's still fun. So,
right. And we did it in Europe. Going to from Paris to
Paris, yeah.
to Disneyland Paris, yeah.
yeah. So great. I'm a big fan of trains.
Yes,
I more train transportation would be a great thing in this country, especially high speed rail. I would love to see much more high speed rail in this country. It works in Europe,
right.
works in other countries around the world. More high speed rail in the U.S. I'd be a big fan of. Moving on to another story, if you've ever looked into the Walt Disney World fountain or water attractions mm-hmm. and wondered, you know, what happens to all those coins guests throw in there? Well, now we know at least what they're doing with some of the coins for 2020. This again from the Orlando Sentinel.com. Even in this pandemic year, tourists tossed some $20,000 in coins into
wow.
the Walt Disney World's wishing wells and fountains in 2020. Money the theme park is turning into a Thanksgiving gift for Central Florida's largest homeless shelter.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah. So the coins are typically dropped in the iconic wishing well at Cinderella's Castle or along the waterways of Fantasylands. It's a Small World, as well mm-hmm. as the fountains throughout all the parks throughout
right.
you know, the Disney resorts. Disney periodically collects, cleans, and sorts the coins before donating them to a Central Florida charity. And this year, as the region's homeless population has risen, including among single mothers and their children, Walt Disney World's Director of External Affairs, Tahiana and Cora Brown, sorry about that, Tahiana, said that the company is settled on giving the bounty to the Coalition for the Homeless.
Nice.
Yeah, so this is a quote. I am just so thankful, especially in light of everything that's going on in the world and everything Disney is going through, said Allison Krall, CEO of the Coalition for the Homeless of Central Florida. We needed this so very much, end
nice.
Quote. So that's great. You know, and I always wondered, I'm like, look at all those coins in there.
Right.
What does Disney do? They just collect them and they just, you know, reimburse, put them back into
right.
the system or whatever. But no, they do donate them regularly. Now, this is what the charity they've picked this year, but they do pick other charities in other years to donate those coins to.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So that was a cool story. So that's it for my Disney stories of the week.
I have one.
You have a story too.
I do.
So that's great. Michelle's stories, always the best stories.
Well, I'm not sure if this is really a story as much as an announcement,
okay.
you know, so, but we're getting close to when it would have been Walt's birthday, December 5th. So this week coming up, the Walt Disney Family Museum is hosting free virtual classes that are, you know, some of them are educational about the organization. Some are fun things to do. I know Fridays is going to be how to create a diorama.
Which you're all about.
I know, right? I can't wait. So anyways, check out the Disney Family Museum website and then you can see where the links are to go to these. They're going to have something every single day of the week leading up to December 5th, which would have have been Walt's birthday.
Very cool. That's cool. Yeah, the Walt Disney Family Museum does so many great things. Mm-hmm. And hopefully we have a cruise scheduled for May that's going to stop in at San Francisco, and we've never been to the Walt Disney Family Museum.
Right.
Hopefully the cruise goes through. Hopefully everything is cool. And hopefully we get to pay a visit while we're in San Francisco.
I know.
That's part of the trip that we're looking forward to the most. So that would be exciting if we do get the chance to do that. And of course, if we do, we will tell you all about it. But they have so many great programs going on.
They do.
They announce things every single week. Ever since this has all gone on, they're doing so much virtual stuff.
Right. Yeah, right. And they do a lot to help with kids going into the animation industry. So they have a calendar every month of things that are going on throughout the weeks. And some things you do pay are a fee, some things are free, but it really is devoted not just to the history of Disney and Walt, the Disney company and Walt Disney, but also, like I said, trying to really help people who are interested in going into the field of animation. And they do scholarships, so they also very much look for donations, etc. So it's definitely, but they have a lot of great information at that website.
Yeah, very cool. Definitely check it out for sure. Mm-hmm. So that's it for the Disney stories of the week. However, we never leave you without giving you some sort of tip that might help you on your next vacation, whether it be to the Walt Disney World Resort. Again, we keep saying this, eventually Disneyland, eventually Disney Cruise, by the way, the Disney Wonder back over from its dry dock over in Paris at Brest, in Brest, France. It was the first Disney ship to make it back over to the mainland. It stopped over in Port Canaveral. I saw pictures of it. I think it was yesterday or the day before. And it's currently out in the waters outside of Florida again. So it's great to see the ships coming back. And hopefully that's good news for what we have coming up eventually once we get through this craziness right now. But anyway, going back to the tips, we always start with Michelle. One, because, she's wonderful, fantastic. She does the best research. She has the best stories. But she definitely has the very best tips. So let's get right to it. Here is Michelle's tip of the week.
Oh, my gosh. You're too kind. So my tip has to do with if you're not a Disney Vacation Club member, tip one is become a Disney Vacation Club member.
If you can afford it.
Right. But if you are not one and you do want to have a booking at one of the Disney Vacation Club resorts, there is a way that you can do that. In fact, you can up to 499 days in advance. You can actually go and research this. To actually make the reservation, though, you do need to call. And that phone number is one that we can put in our newsletter.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'll put it out there. But it's a great way, especially if you're going as a family and you want like multiple bedrooms or even just a one bedroom so that you also have, a full kitchen and washer and dryer. And, some of them have two bathrooms. But there are ways. Sometimes you can, when you're searching online for a reservation, you can find some of those. But sometimes the best way to do it is just to actually go to the phone number and call them and get some assistance with booking a Disney Vacation Club villa.
Right. And they're not necessarily cheap, the cheapest rooms, because there are bigger rooms that you're going to find. But if you're looking to spend a little more, want a little more room, it's worth a shot.
Right. Or if you have, like I said, if you have a large family that you're coming together with, or friends and family, and you they do have 2 and 3 bedroom resorts as well there, you may save some money on food or something like that, or just want to all be together and have that time to not only explore the parks, but to come back as a family and be together in the resort. That's a nice way to do it.
That's great. Yeah. And the other option also is to go out and look to see about renting people's vacation club points and putting that. When you do that, though, you're not quite in as much control as if you're. So you're probably paying a bit more by doing it this way. But you are complete control of your reservation, whereas when you're renting points, sometimes while that's easy and you can save a lot of money, you lose a little control there. And weigh your options in those regards when you're trying to decide what's best for you and your family.
Right. And, with the vacation club villas, they're very much seasonally impacted by how much, well, you know, for a vacation club you're using, if you're using as a member, points. So I would expect that if you're paying cash, that it's very much, you might have, you know, one day to the next, a big difference in the cost per night, you know, but looking at the duration of your stay, averaging it out.
Right. Good point.
So, and so the phone number that you can call for Disney Vacation Club Villa Resort reservations is 407-939-1936.
Why don't you give it one more time just so they, sure, they're grabbing a pen.
That's true. 407-939-1936.
There you go. So again, Michelle's tips, always the best tips. For my tip of the week, I'm stealing another tip from our wonderful friends, Rob and Kim from the Hoopty Duo Review. They just released a great episode where they kind of recapped their recent 13-day trip out to Orlando, mostly to the Walt Disney World Resort, but also to Universal Orlando as well. And they went through, they stayed at three different places, one off-site, a couple on-site at the Walt Disney World Resort. A lot of the food they tried, they went over so much food.
It was great.
But you should definitely check out their episode to kind of find out what's going on with them. One, just they do a great show anyway. A lot of reviews of some things you might be interested in, but they're just great people and they did a great show. Anyway, they mentioned that on that recent trip to the Walt Disney World Resort, that they ran into a family that had made a dining reservation for a park that didn't have a park pass reservation for that park. They had it for a different park. And so they were denied entry into that park, which is that what we have right now. If you have made a park pass reservation for, let's just say, Magic Kingdom, and then you have a dining reservation that you've made, which you can do for later at Disney's Hollywood Studios, for example. Right now, as we stand, you cannot switch. You can switch your park reservation if you have availability before the day of that to mesh with your dining reservation, but you cannot. You can cancel your dining reservation, but you cannot do both. You cannot go to one park and then go over and dine at the other where your dining reservation is.
Right.
And there is, you know, you lose money on that unless you can convince Disney that maybe they'll give it back. So, you know, you want to know that you can't do that. And even when we get to January 1st, 2021, when the park hopper option is opening up again, yes, you will have a park pass reservation for one park, and then you may possibly be able to go to a different park later in the day. But there are no guarantees that you can get in there, you know, because it's going to be still based on capacity.
Right.
It's still way up in the air. So I would tell you to be very careful about making a dining reservation later at the day, even at that point, for another park, just because you don't want to run into a problem where you can't make it. One, it just adds more stress to your day. Even if Disney does say, okay, we understand, we thought you could make it into this park, and unfortunately you can't, so we'll reimburse you, we won't charge you your fee that we normally would have for missing a reservation. Why do you want to go through that hassle of having to sit, wait, talk to guest services and everything else? Just be smart about it. I mean, if you really want to try it and you think you can make it, fine. But just know that it's a gamble.
Right.
You know, and so it's up to you on weighing what will be most important for you. Is it worth it to take that gamble for the fact that you might be able to dine in this separate park later on in the day?
Exactly. Yeah. And what you mentioned too is important, is you know, to have that hassle factor issue, you know, whether, you know, it's just the frustration of not being able to go there, or now having to talk to somebody, get into another, you know, queue, whether it be virtual or in real queue, and talk to somebody to make sure you get that cancellation fee waived if they can do that for you. But yeah, I agree with you. That's a great tip. Just, you know, go with what you know.
Right. For sure. And also, by the way, be sure what your ticket is too, because you may have a ticket that's not a park hopper ticket. You could set all this up and not be able to go park hop to another park. So make sure you either have an annual pass or a ticket with the park hopper option onto it.
Right.
If you do decide to take the chance and go for, you know, this dining reservation in a different park. But again, you know, you just don't want to mess with your trip too much. You know, again, it can be trippy. A trip can be hectic enough, but then when you have hungry kids right. and everything, and you're expecting to go eat in this restaurant, and you find out that it's reached capacity and they're not allowing any more people in, sure. whatever. And again, you can look, we don't know how this is going to work out when Park Hopper option opens up.
Right.
You could look, and especially if this is several weeks down, and you can see how this function is working, how people have the availability right. to go to other parks. And if you see it's working pretty well, that there are very few times that the parks are reaching capacity where they're turning people away,
right,
then maybe you go for it. But I would, especially early on, I'd be very, very careful about this.
So, right, exactly. Yeah.
So that's it for this week. Next week, well, we'll be in the month of December. We're almost there. It's hard to believe. So the world will be fully entrenched in the holiday season. Not that it's not kind of that way already. And we're going to take that fact and run with it. So, you know, at least we're going to take a little stroll with it. A little stroll around World Showcase with it, as a matter of fact. We're going to take a virtual stroll around Epcot and explore the many holiday traditions around World Showcase. So basically, yay, like all the countries, regions that are around World Showcase, Michelle's going to do some more fantastic research and explore some of the holiday traditions that you would run into in these various countries.
Right. I think we're going to do some divide and conquer.
Oh, is that
research.
It? Oh, yeah. Okay. So whatever countries Michelle works on, those are going to be really, really great. She's going to have lots of information. Me, I'm going to be like, you know, this country, it's fun.
They have food. It's holiday related.
And music. It's fun. No, we'll have a lot of fun. So
yes.
I can't wait to hear what countries Michelle divvies up for me. But I'm excited. And that should be a lot of fun and a good way to start kicking off the month of December as we move through the holiday season.
Exactly.
Yeah. So we appreciate that you joined us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
you'll want to sign up for our newsletter.
Please sign up for the newsletter. It's just kind of a way to be more in the Hyperion Adventures podcast. No, I'm going to share the link, by the way, for our appearance on the Conversations mm-hmm. podcast. It will, one, be in the newsletter. I will also have it in our show notes for today, too. So you definitely should go check out that episode. Sign up for the newsletter anyways, but definitely right. check out that episode of us with Conversations, because it's just so much fun.
Yeah, they're great, and we had a blast.
Yeah, Pat and Charles are the best. So also, please follow us on social media. We like to be active and have a lot of fun out on social media. You can find us on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. Be sure to check us out on YouTube as well to see some of the pictures and different things we add on to some of these episodes. And my hair continues to grow. You can check that out. I don't know when I'm going to get it cut, because I'm still, you know, things have gotten a little crazy now. And, you know, with this holiday, we don't know what's going to happen in the next few weeks. So it may be a few more weeks, but you can kind of, still, I think it's a fun game to play. How much more is the hair falling into Tom's face throughout the episode?
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah, fun for me. At least when I'm editing these things, I'm like, look at my hair. It's driving me crazy, but it's fun. Anyway, just do a search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast on YouTube and hit subscribe, and you'll know whenever we have a new video. And if you ever want to connect with us for any reason, please feel free to hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right. We love hearing from you. We love the interactions you have with us on that, and we appreciate when you do connect with us.
Yes, very much so. So that's it for today. Thank you for listening to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We look forward to sharing some time with you again next week. Until that time, I'm Tom.
I'm Michelle.
And we hope that you have a magical week. Bye.